More often than not, time in the NFL proves to be a flat circle. The days and weeks fall off of the calendar, yet same storylines just repeat time after time. And one of the most poignant examples of this is the Chicago Bears' eternal struggle to lock down a franchise quarterback. Names like Kyle Orton or Rex Grossman ring a bell? Anyway, the latest iteration of this timeless tale, their decision to draft Mitchell Trubisky out of the University of North Carolina with the number 2 overall pick for the 2017 NFL Draft. This made Mitch just the 6th quarterback to be taken by the Bears in the top 5 in franchise history, and the first since Jim McMahon back in 1982. The decision to take Trubisky was met with criticism for a number of reasons. For starters, the Bears had just brought in Mike Glennon, another middling quarterback, on a 3-year, $45 million deal. Critics had plenty of questions for the Bears on this move, too. Glennon had accomplished almost nothing at the professional level, and even worse, it seemed like the Bears were really the only team interested in his services, meaning that they must have negotiated against themselves with that contract. Anyways, even after the Glennon signing, the Bears felt that they needed to bring Trubisky into the fold, despite the fact that no one really even knew about Trubisky before his breakout junior year at UNC. Pro Football Focus described Trubisky as polished as a passer playing with good balance and consistent mechanics, which leads him to throw with great accuracy in the short, intermediate passing game. But he really wasn't on anyone's radar until he broke out during his 2016-17 college season. Sure, during his junior year he completed 68% of his passes for 2,748 yards and 30 touchdowns, while only surrendering 6 interceptions. But in his first 2 seasons, he had only completed 82 passes across 18 games played. Not exactly a resume that would normally blow away NFL scouts. But nonetheless, the Bears' brass were enthralled. They loved Trubisky's accuracy, his propensity to look downfield while reading the defense, and perhaps most of all, his athleticism and the ability it gave him to extend plays. A lot of draft evaluators in the media were high on him too. ESPN and Pro Football Focus ranked Trubisky the 2nd best quarterback, NFLDraftScout.com ranked him as the top quarterback in the draft, and Sports Illustrated ranked him as the 4th best quarterback available. But perhaps his biggest fan of all was the Bears general manager Ryan Pace, who had an unwavering belief that Trubisky had all of the markings of a championship quarterback. He was emphatic. "When you have an opportunity to get a quarterback of this caliber, you can't pass on it," Pace said to the Chicago Tribune. He likened his paranoia that someone would scoop up his prized draft prospect to the challenges of navigating agents in free agency, saying, "It's like in free agency when the agent tells you he's got 3 other teams he's working with. You never really know. You've just got to trust your conviction on it, and if you want a player, you aggressively go get him." And trust his conviction he did, regardless of what anyone else around the league or in the house thought. He claimed that then-head coach John Fox was just as high on Trubisky as he was, saying, "John and I are arm in arm in all these decisions." But it was later revealed that Fox didn't even know about the plan to take Mitch until just a couple of hours before the pick was made. It turned out that Fox was so far out of the loop that Pace didn't even have his head coach attend Trubisky's pro day. Instead, he sent their director of college scouting, Mark Sadowski, national scout Ryan Kesenich, and area scout Chris Prescott to Trubisky's actual pro day. So where was John Fox during all of this? Pace sent him to watch Deshaun Watson, where Fox spent nearly the entire day talking to the Tigers head coach, Dabo Swinney, about his standout QB. Talk about having some serious organizational dysfunction. It sounds to me like Pace knew what he wanted, and it couldn't have mattered less to him what Fox or anyone else for that matter thought. In fact, Pace felt so strongly about this that he joked he went to a number of the quarterback's college games and watched from the stands in a disguise. Apparently the disguise was effective, because no one knew how all-in the Bears were on Mitch. UNC quarterbacks coach Keith Heckendorf confirmed this by saying, "I talked to so many different people throughout the process. I know early on the Bears had an interest, but I can't say they did anything extraordinary." Anyway, the point is, Ryan Pace needed Trubisky in a Bears uniform, and he really wasn't willing to take any chances in landing him. The Bears were coming off of a dreadful season and had the number 3 overall pick in the draft, which should have definitely been high enough to land Trubisky. But Pace needed a guarantee. He felt like Trubisky was that special of a talent, and apparently he showed his hand far too early and ended up trading up from the number 3 slot to number 2 after working out a deal with John Lynch and the San Francisco 49ers. In addition to the pick swap, the Bears doled out their 3rd round pick, which was 67th overall, the number 111th pick, which the 49ers promptly used to move up from number 34 to 31, and grab Reuben Foster and a future third-round pick. While this isn't the haul that the Redskins gave up to get RG3, or the infamous The Great Train Robbery that launched the Cowboys dynasty in the 90s, it was still a lot to give up to move just one slot for a guy that no other team seemed to have that high on their draft board. Wait, Ryan Pace and the Bears bidding against themselves for a questionable quarterbacking prospect? Stop me if you've heard this one before. The Bears' incompetence wasn't limited to their actual negotiations with the quarterbacks. As it turns out, they also ended up bidding against themselves when it came to the actual trade. The general consensus ahead of the 2017 draft was that there was no surefire home run prospect at the top of the draft. In fact, the 49ers had been shopping their number 2 overall pick the entire week leading up to the draft and had no serious suitors. But that didn't stop Pace and the Bears from mortgaging their future to move up one measly spot in the draft. Sure, the 49ers wouldn't trade Jimmy Garoppolo for several months, and they didn't have a franchise quarterback at the time, but their roster was littered with holes and they gave every indication that they would try to trade back to try and fill multiple needs instead of reaching for a QB they weren't sure of. Interestingly, although he was the only one ready to spring on Trubisky that high in the draft, he wasn't the only GM on draft day anxious to jump up in order to get their guy. In a matter of just 1 hour, two other teams traded up to take a home run swing and landing a franchise quarterback. The Chiefs moved up 17 spots from number 27 to number 10 to draft Patrick Mahomes, and the Texans went from number 25 to number 12 to bring Clemson product Deshaun Watson to Houston. I wonder who feels the best about their draft day bravado today. The fact of the matter is that the price hardly mattered to Pace. He wanted his guy, and he got him. But the question remains, why? Why was Ryan Pace so insanely high on a quarterback that he had hardly done anything at the college level? It wasn't Madden creative player-level arm strength like Pat Mahomes, and it wasn't the dominance and leadership that Watson showed at Clemson. He liked his athleticism and thought he could be a good pro quarterback, but as it turns out, his enchantment with the former UNC quarterback had nothing to do with anything Trubisky ever did on the gridiron. Ryan Pace's love affair with Mitch Trubisky started on a random March night when he and the rest of the Bears decision-makers were scheduled to dine with the quarterback at Ben 54, a high-end steakhouse in Chapel Hill. Besides Pace and Trubisky, it was head coach John Fox, offensive coordinator Dow Loggins, QB coach Dave Ragone, and director of player personnel Josh Lucas. They booked a private dining room and were set to pick the quarterback's brain on anything and everything to find out exactly who Mitch Trubisky was. The conversation was deeply personal, and the evening ended up resembling a first date more than a business meeting. They learned all about the quarterback off the field, that he grew up a huge Ohio State fan, and that he loves the game Pictionary. All things that totally translate to success on the football field, right? Pace was smitten. He was taken back by the Ohio kid's humility and his outlook on life, especially after hearing how he had sworn to stick it out at UNC instead of transferring when he wasn't named a starter at North Carolina during his first 3 seasons. It was far from one-sided, though. Trubisky raved about the evening as well, claiming that it was different from any of the other 10-plus dinners they had sat down for with various NFL teams. "This felt like my favorite group of coaches that I met with," he said. "I felt like I was really connecting with them, like I went on the best first date." Sounds like it really was a magical night in Chapel Hill. The dinner concluded and Pace offered to walk Mitch out to his car, just like any good date would, and it was in that moment that Pace knew for sure that he had to take him, no matter what it took. It wasn't anything that was said on the walk. He didn't see him toss a stray stone a country mile or anything like that. The moment of truth happened when they arrived in front of Trubisky's car, and Pace laid his eyes on the beige 1997 Toyota Camry in the lot of Ben 54, presumably shining in the moonlight. He was taken back. Here was a kid, in line to make millions of dollars, who came from a well-to-do family, and he was driving a beat-up old Camry. From that night on, it was all but a done deal. Trubisky was going to be a Chicago Bear. It was just a matter of time. And on that day, sure enough, the Bears pushed their chips to the middle of the table, traded up, and drafted Trubisky 2nd overall. When Pace called Trubisky on draft night, it was the first time that the two had spoken since their blissful night in Chapel Hill back in March. Pace was terrified to tip his hand to any rival teams, so he withheld any and all communications after that night. But when Trubisky's phone did ring and it was Pace on the other end, the quarterback was over the moon that the team he had felt such a strong connection with had finally came back to him. "I'm glad I landed in the right spot," the 22-year-old quarterback told the Chicago Tribune. "We're going to make it work. It's going to be perfect." The kicker? Pace confirmed the real reason that the Bears drafted Trubisky on the call, telling the QB, "Hey, you gotta promise me one thing. You got to promise me one thing, okay? You're going to drive your beat-up car here. Don't change a thing with it. Unreal. It was a beat-up Toyota Camry that landed Trubisky in Chicago while Deshaun Watson and Patrick Mahomes were still available. And that is why there is such a disparity in the quality of NFL programs, because some teams make decisions based off of analytics or game tape, and some make their decisions based off of the car that their prospects drive. If you're new here and you haven't subscribed yet, now's a great time to do that by clicking the subscribe button down below. If you like the video, then like the video. We'd really appreciate it. And last but not least, don't forget to tune into TPS every single day for more cool videos.